Okay, now, I should say one more thing before I start on the Dolch sight words. I was told in, or I was, it was written in a comment from a workshop that I did at the National Learning Disabilities Conference, which was, I love those kind of conferences. I love the gifted and the learning disability conferences because they are just rich with backdoor learning teachers. In other words, those kind of teachers that if they have to teach things the way that typically and traditionally they're taught, they would get nowhere. Because if you teach learners with exceptionalities, even if it's ESL, if you have SLD, if you have learning delays, if you have language delays, if you have any sort of exceptionality student, including gifted, AIG, you have a backdoor learner. You have a learner that just doesn't follow the route like your typical student from A to B to C. And they might need to go from A to D, circle F twice, and then head back to B in order to get to C. And these teachers that work with these particular populations are masters at thinking out of the box, because really very little in the box applies to what they do in the course of their day. So talking to them usually is just like connecting with your alter ego. Classroom teachers, it's a perk to have the capability to work both inside and outside the box, because you will have learners, obviously, that are out of the box thinkers in terms of their needs. And I don't necessarily in this case mean out of the box as in a good thing. I mean out of the box as in more challenging and feeling more challenged to get to where the rest of the class might get with your typical regular instruction. In any event, all of this to say that one of the comments I got that you might want to keep in mind as I go through this was that listening to Katie's workshop, and I guess you could call this a double-edged sword compliment, or not compliment, comment, because you could take it one way or the other, but I choose to take it as the positive. She said, was kind of like having, it wasn't like attending a workshop, it was like having coffee with a very chatty friend who had no particular order to what she was sharing, nor seemingly any specified sequence, however, was extremely knowledgeable about the content and so excited and passionate to get it all out that you just couldn't stop listening and you could just go on and on talking for hours. That's kind of, I think, what I do in workshop. It's good, it's bad, it's both. It just depends on your style as a learner, but it's certainly what I'm doing in these vlogs, and it's because I feel the pressure to get as much as I can out, make it as clear as I'm capable of making it in a vlog situation, and having an audience that is coming from a knowledge or use of secret stories, which is a whole different experience and perspective than that part of the audience that's coming in cold as your regular classroom teacher. So having said that, keep that in mind as I go forward, because I will be making reference to both types of audience. I'll try to be as clear as I can, but depending on where your hat is, and you might want to think about that right now, whether you do use the secrets or whether you don't, your context of what I say will be relative. And I'm going to try to keep that in mind and clarify as I can on both ends. Now, to start with what's most traditional, it's our 220 Dolch sight words. I have seen so many different ways of taking these and dividing them up. Typically, the most traditional way to divide them up is like we do with everything else that involves reading, writing, and spelling, and that could be a whole other vlog entry, which is by grade level. Give them this much at K, this much at first, this much at second. Now, here's the thing. When you take all of these Dolch words and you put them up on a wall, you can see that these Dolch words, which we have now basically, you know, deemed as our general body of sight words, are actually phonetic. Although it's said and children are told that these words can't be sounded out and therefore have to be learned through sight, it's really not true. I would say there's about 10 of them out of 220 that actually have to be learned by sight. Now, that's not to say they're the most perfect students in the class, which means not every word does exactly what it should, exactly the way it's supposed to, based on all the words and all those phonics rules we have in English. No, they don't. Not at all. And that goes back to like the word have that we talked about in the other vlog entry. It's not doing exactly what it should. If it were, it would behave. But it certainly isn't falling so far away from the tree that we can't consider what else A can say and come up with that word. As far as the E throwing us off at the end, it shouldn't, because it's just doing what every other E does at the end of a word, which is nothing. It's just telling the vowel to say its name, except in this case it isn't. And that's why it's have and not have. When you have this kind of mindset and you go through that Dolch list, you will be dumbfounded and amazed to see how those words really have the ability to be mastered as a reinforcement of the sounds that we work on every day, meaning you can use those words for purposes of sound skill reinforcement if you choose, instead of abandoning those skills that we worked so hard on from day one in kindergarten and pre-K, which is sound and symbol relationships, A says A, B says B, C says C, C says C, all those patterns that we go through every day only to then abandon them as soon as we tell kids they have to memorize this flash word. You can use them instead, if you choose, to reinforce those skills. Now, many teachers might think that the point of a sight word is say it quick, know it right away. You have to be able to say it quickly for fluency. Yeah, you do, but we read those words really quickly, and we didn't memorize them, typically, depending on how old you are. You don't have to memorize something in order to say it quickly. In a matter of fact, you can read it just as quickly as you memorize it, because once the brain owns it, it owns it the same way. The combination of the right and the left side of the brain and how they approach text, whereas one is patterning things out by a phonemic sound, the other is patterning out based on what it already knows. Both don't have to line up perfectly. And this is part of where my focus is with Stenhouse, looking at words once you're already a reader, where letters can be completely jumbled with perhaps only 2 out of 12 actually being in the right place. And yet a knowledgeable, advanced reader can immediately identify that word, even though there is no connection with those sound symbol relationships. It's because they already own the pattern, and it's a combination of both sides of the brain working together in how we actually come forward as readers and writers. Now that's a lot to say. What I think I really want to hit on is which of these words that are these Dulch words I would say are sight words. And I mean, from a secret story perspective, I'd stick them in jail. They're going to go straight to jail. I'm going to clarify why these words that I'm about to tell you would be considered words that go to jail versus other words that one might think need to go to jail or go to a sight word wall, but actually can be worked through, can be figured out. Now, just to look really quickly at the very first, what's called the pre-primer list, and I did put this up. You can see it at the beginning and the ending of this vlog, and it is from Sierra Vista Software. They have it copyrighted, and you can access this on your own as well at www.k5stars.com. It's just a cute little cheat sheet that I found and thought that I could use it as a quick reference for this activity. In the pre-primer list, the word come. Obviously, that is a word I would stick in jail. Now, there's a few reasons for this, but mainly it's because it's not worth the time it would take to try to figure it out, given that the vowel sound, that O sound, is not one. By the time they try to make the long O sound, and then they try to flip it and try a short O sound, it's going to take them forever and a day, if even they hear it well enough to figure out it might be the short U sound, and then therefore the word would become. So that is a word I would certainly go ahead and just put up on that word jail and let the kids memorize. However, the word blue, I would not, because that follows that secret, two vowels go walking, first one does the talking, and it always says its name. Blue, blue, blue. Now, you might think I'm saying that funny, but many of our words that we speak with an American accent, if you look at our language and the way that it was originally spoken, you have a British tone, a British accent to their production. So when you listen, and this is actually one of the strategies I share when we see secrets that don't work, which is speak like a Brit. So a word like blue or flute or schedule, you actually hear the U saying its name. Blue, flute, flute. You wouldn't think that flute would be spelled F-L-O-O-T like we would in America say flute, flu, flute, F-L-O-O-T, if you were British, because you wouldn't call it a flute. You'd call it a flute, flute. You can hear the U saying its name because the mommy E is at the end. So you can kind of get around and actually use as a talking or a teaching point some of the patterns, these secret stories, to show that it works. Kids like to have a place for everything and everything in its place. The brain likes to have a place for everything and everything in its place. It will actually work very hard to make things pull together in that way. So when you can show that they are able to rely on something they already know to get to a word that they don't, and then use that same tool to apply to be able to read other words, it's a real empowering capability that you're bestowing upon learners. And that's one that words like blue or flute or schedule offer us. So I wouldn't necessarily put blue in jail. I would just consider it one of our learning words, one of the words that we can play with and learn something from having attacked it.